see plagiarism, what they find, what is acceptable and what is not, and why. So,
I want to thank our college and department for the opportunity to talk about this. I've been working on my dissertation for about 2 years, and I'm not ready to wrap it up. And my focus is on ethics. I've been a businessman and an educator for 30, 40 years. And my local area is the ethics in the world. I've been engaged in it very early on. I mean, when it was allowed in college after employees, which is not forbidden by law, but I've had just a lot of experience with ethical and unethical behavior in people. So it's an area that is really important to our society. So it's where I chose to spend all my research on. Anyway, I thank you for the opportunity, and hopefully I can show you some of the things that I've learned. And I've learned a lot in this research, so it's not like I knew it for the beginning. It's always been very eye-opening and interesting. Okay. Anyway, let's keep it in the context of what's good for our students and children and, you know, young people. Not what we want to do as educators, but what we think. And the way I see this going to make it work is we have to handle it by education. We have to handle it by educating the students. And setting stellar examples ourselves. You can't just say, do as I say, and not what I do. Very quick. So anytime you hear me talking, it should be in that context. If not, tell me. You guys are very familiar, and that's not right. This is what we want. Anyway, what is plagiarism? Well, you know, I'm not going to go into it in any detail, but it comes from a Latin word. A poet by Dean Marshall used the word because somebody stole his poems, and he referred to it as kidnapping, and that's where the word comes from. It's a serious social science issue. You know, it's not really a natural science. This is all human issue. So it is very good for us to study in the social areas. Any kind of ethics is, we should be studying it more. But the problem is, it's hard to get a handle on. How do you measure somebody being unethical? Certainly not through surveys. Who would do that? You know, so we can only ask them, do they understand what ethical is or what plagiarism is, things like that. Anyway, it really started in America, which the seriousness of it was when sermons were stolen. You know, we became a society of all little communities across the whole country, and we had all these churches, and our social life was around churches. And there was quite a bit of stealing of sermons. And that's where it really became a really critical part of our society, where we started recognizing the problem. I want to talk about just some humorous things, or maybe not so humorous to some people, but Johnny Cash, these are a series of plagiarism examples, high profile, that we see. And of course, high profile is not a problem. It, you know, plagiarism isn't plagiarism until somebody complains. You know, maybe a new professor's complaining about another professor that they're getting all the accolades and they're not, and they're finding plagiarism in some other's work. So it can be really serious. Some students are angry because they know other people are plagiarizing tons and they're not getting as good as grades as some of those people have. So it's really a fairness issue, and many times it's brought to light because somebody complains. And in Johnny Cash's instances, he wrote Folsom Prison Blues, and of course there's just a lot of mystery behind the story behind that. Many of you have seen the movie, you know. But he borrowed the song from a song called Crescent City Blues, and that's what was playing when you came in. If you hear long enough to hear it, you probably heard that, the two songs. And they're not exactly alike, but the melody's the same. Many of the lyrics are. Johnny Cash added a different version about a verse about shooting somebody, but when you listen to these two songs, you can just hear and see where there's a problem, you know. And he settled that for, I think, $75,000. So, and that was in 1954. That is a lot of money. I mean, I think I went through an inflation chart, and it came out to about $700,000. So it wasn't peanuts, you know, the $70,000. So real critical. So, and of course, this is a copyright issue, and that's why there's really money involved. Much of the plagiarism we see, there's not, there may or may not be copyright issues with it where people will go to court over it. But it's still on a lesser scale. Oh, I love Doris Kearns Goodwin. She was, if you saw the movies or the series, like, I think the Civil War or something like that. I can't remember. It was a PBS series, and she was in it quite a bit. They quoted her, and she spoke, and so she has books on the South and the Civil War and presidents and like that. Anyway, she was accused of plagiarism, and they confirmed it. She had to withdraw a book and correct it. Because she had copied phrases out of other books. And again, they don't really say the details. I mean, when you evaluate plagiarism, you have to actually see it, highlight it in the two documents, and see how similar it is. You know? And we'll talk about that a little bit later. Joe Biden, when he was running for, was it president or vice president, one of his elections he was running for, much younger, he plagiarized a lot of different speeches that he found good parts in. And who would? You know, that sounds really good. I'll use it in my stump speech. But the problem is, if it's really unique and somebody else has done it, it does create a problem. Anyway, Eric, you know how we are with politics these days. Anytime anybody gets up to talk, all the press then ask you about all the bad things. So once that happens, it follows you around forever. So you really don't want that to happen. Senator John Walsh. This is something that affects all our students. We got a really impressive one. He plagiarized his dissertation. Well, you know, there's actually a page in there, a whole page copy. They took his degree away from him. And that is serious. I mean, I really want to be careful that I don't spend 5 years working on my degree, and 5 years from now, it's taken away from me. You know, and you basically have to start over. If you're so inclined, I think that would really be very disheartening. So anyway, but you can see he, you know, a nice guy probably, I'm sure, it has nothing to do with it, but he copied stuff in his works and it cost him his degree. Martin Luther King, the same thing. They found a lot of his document was plagiarized too. In fact, before he was assassinated, there was a lot of inquiry about it and it may have come to fruition. You know, he might have lost his degree too. But after the assassination, I think they just dropped it, which is in good taste, honestly. They wrote a part at the end of it saying, well, there is plagiarism in this thing, but it did contribute to the knowledge base. So that was okay. But honestly, that would not be normal. If they found substantial plagiarism, they would not say, well, the rest of it was good. That would just probably mix it and probably have degrees revoked. This is really important. Mary Giraldo, she was, I tried to verify this as much as I could. And I hope this isn't false news, but I really checked it out and found two or three sources, but they're kind of related. Since it's in another country, it's kind of hard to always find things out. But according to what I found out there, it was in a published article that was part of some journal. And so she was put in 2 years prison because in Colombia it's against the law, not a civil problem, but even a legal problem. They put her in because she stole a student's thesis, literally turned it into an article, and took credit for it without giving the student credit. It wasn't like a thing. And so she suffered quite a bit. So, you know, that's an extreme. We don't prosecute, it's a civil matter. Doesn't mean it can't kill a career or anything like that, but it's not where you go to prison for in our country. Except, and I'll say it right now in case I forget it, if you have an NSF grant with federal monies involved and you do plagiarism, it's in there. They can prosecute. That's fraud, and it's fraud against the government, wasting federal money. I don't know I could find any example that's happened, but it is possible. So, I mean, even our country, if you go to that extreme, you can handle the problems. And, of course, I'm not going to go over this. I don't want to be political, but, you know, we all know what happened to Melania Trump, because she, supposedly, that's Meredith McIver, which was her writer, said over the phone, she either gave her those sentences, so Melania must have been looking at her speech, or she said, I really like a lot what Mrs. Obama said. And then her writer went and did that, but it's still, there's no excuse for it. And they paid a political price for it. I mean, that was on the news for like at least a month. You know, it's a major issue. But let's see. Monica Crowley, okay. She was going to be appointed to the cabinet by Trump. And she lost that position because her book had a lot of plagiarism in it. She's a reporter, and they were going to put her in charge of the communications, I guess. And they found so much plagiarism in some of her books, probably just little segments that she copied from different news sources and didn't give them credit. And so that was taken away. And then while they were reporting this, somebody went into her PhD and examined her dissertation, and it also had plagiarism in it. And so I haven't heard whether they proceeded further on that, but she may have her PhD revoked too. So that may take a while for that to go through the system, and there may be civil action one way or another. So it's some place where none of us want to go, you know. Vladimir Putin, it doesn't matter what he did. He could have copied his whole plagiarism dissertation. You know, there's no recourse against him, but he did. He copied very much out of a book, his dissertation, much of it without crediting anybody. And so it was pretty serious. But again, nothing's ever been done about it, and it never will, you know, so we all can face that reality. President Trump. Oh, I kind of wanted to talk about reverse plagiarism a little bit, and I'll talk about that again in a little bit. Reverse plagiarism, we're used to it from students. You have to have 5 references in your paper. They just go out and pick 5. They're not, that's reverse plagiarism. You're taking something that you said, and you're giving somebody else credit, either just because you're lazy and you need to, or you just want somebody's really good name on the things you said. You know, so reverse plagiarism can kind of be serious too. And so in this case, you know, he's telling about the Swedish attack, and then he's saying who said that, and they, you know, it was Fox News said that. So in a way, he's reverse plagiarism. You know, he's just talking and giving somebody else credit to take it off him. And I'll talk about a little. I got another example that was kind of really interesting to talk about later. But anyway, oh, and then this is kind of getting out of hand. There's plagiarism involved with that cake. Yeah, one under Obama, they built that cake just like that, and somehow they built the same cake but with a different baker. And so one baker's considering suing the other over copywriting. And so the plagiarism thing can get out of hand. It's very serious, but you know, I think some people really take it to the extreme. And I don't know, maybe there's something so unique with that that maybe it is patentable. I don't know. Or if it's copyrighted, if it expresses a statement. So you know, there's a humorous side and a serious side to this. Okay, why do we care? You know, I think the two things is, one, learning is writing. If you're not going to write it and all you do is copy things together, we already have computers can do that. You can pick a topic and they can all put it together. You know, I don't think it's going to be very long until we have computers writing our essays and dissertations and studies, big parts of them, you know. So if we don't have our students writing, they're not learning. It doesn't really matter to me whether they're doing this, but they're not learning. And so that's why I want to stop it. You know, we just are not going to learn anything if they don't write themselves. Even if they're not good writers, they need to do it, but we need to then guide them through the process, and not just, oh, you're a bad writer. So, you know, there's a deep one right there, right off the bat. Also, plagiarism exaggerates the importance. If you keep repeating stuff, you know, you do a search and 20 sources come up, man, I hit the jackpot. I've got a lot of research I could do. Well, if half those are plagiarized, you don't. You don't have a lot. You just have some. Maybe just one. Maybe everything else is plagiarized. So it is critical to you know, not exaggerate the importance of it. And plagiarism tends to do that in most examples. the types of plagiarism used to be there was just plagiarism. And I think that's outdated now. There's just too much else going on. You just can't say plagiarism. And then we say self-plagiarism as like, well, that's not really plagiarism. It's just, you know, we'll just add an adjective on the front of it. When I was talking and writing, I thought, God, this is confusing when I'm talking about plagiarism and self-plagiarism. So what I did is I kind of labeled them a little differently here. Plagiarism encompasses everything, okay? And I think that's the way we're going. It may not be quite acceptable yet, but I think that's the way it is. And then there's plagiarism of others. Clearly, you're talking about plagiarizing other people, other sources. Then there's plagiarism of self on an equal level. Now, it's never been there before. It kind of keeps coming up and up and up and up. I went through one study, and the guy says, well, it was outside the scope to talk about plagiarism itself, so we just didn't cover it. Our figures are only for plagiarism. So, I mean, there have been studies that just won't deal with it at all, even though it comes back on with Turnitin reports as being a serious problem. So, but there are other editors now that are really digging down hard on it. So I think times are changing. But anyway, plagiarism of others, you know, the common form is a document. Well, who would copy a whole document? I found a study where somebody from the African continent, one of the universities there, he wrote up a study about agriculture. It was the same study, word for word, as one out of Kansas. It wasn't anything different at all except for the data. The data was different. Other than that, it was all identical. Except the totals were the same, too. We had different data, but all the totals and all the stats were exactly the same. So, obviously, they just went through the paper and changed a few things to make it look like, well, you know, like that. And he presented it and it was published. You know. So, that's rare. That's the only one. I've looked at almost 800 documents, and that's the only one I've ever found like that. So, that is rare. Copying paragraphs, of course, is where it's all at right now. Everybody just copies little things here and there and puts them in the paper. We also have paraphrasing, which really paraphrasing is a failure of a paragraph copy. One of the things I get my students involved in is to see what it looks like when Turnitin comes back. Because paraphrasing would be a paragraph with little white spots in it all over where they've changed the words. You wonder if they go to the thesaurus and just say, oh, okay, I'll change that word for this one, like that. And when they're done, they have what they think is a new paragraph, technically, but it's not. You know, they need quotes around it. Or why even bother to change it? Just put the quotes around it and don't mess with it. Layered citations. This is something we all have problems with. I do too. Is how far do you dig back for a reference? You know, you read a paper, there's a reference there, and then there's another reference within that reference. Or you need to go down and find that one if it's that apparent. Some people say it doesn't matter whether there's that second one, you still need to dig farther. Because maybe there is somebody there that went, well, I don't know if that's really practical. How far can you go back to the 50s? We only have electronic documents. If you're knowledgeable in your area, of course, you'll know who presented the theory in the first place, maybe. So that helps. So it depends on how knowledgeable you are. But at least you should drill down, or what they call snowballing, down into the level where you see them referenced, and then they have a reference. And so that's very difficult. Layered citations are difficult to solve. Maybe as technology improves, maybe some of the things can pull those up easier, you know, and say, you know, they're embedded. But it is difficult. Then you get into plagiarism of self. Again, you know, they can be documents, paragraphs, paraphrased too. That's not the point. But duplicate publication is the big problem with plagiarism of self. People will submit to two journals at a time because they figure, you know, they'll get one but maybe not the other, and then they get both of them, then there's a problem. You know. Oftentimes when somebody does a study, you know, it's a two-year effort to do a study maybe, and so they want more than one paper out of it, and they'll tend to maybe have four people in the team, and so each person will take that study and write their own version of it and vary it. And if it's totally different, you know, you can probably maybe get that passed, but it rarely is. There's sections that are exactly the same, and it's just not a good idea to like take a study, then take the same study but break it down to a group. You know, that should really, according to the APA, that should just be all in one study. If you're going to study groups, you know, it's the same data. When you get into data redundancy, that's an issue where you're using the same data over and over again, looking at it differently. Now again, if you're looking at some federal, like the Census Bureau, yeah, you're probably going to get several studies out of that if that's your thing, because it's just so big. But if it's your survey of 800 people, you should be covering that in one study, not breaking it apart in most cases. Text recycling is another thing, is a lot of people like to, you know, they become experts in a field, and so they like to, maybe the introduction has been used in several papers. Not a good idea. I don't know that I think it's really immoral, but it's just the way we've set up the business ethics of academic research that it just shouldn't be done. You know, and I'll show, if my connection stays up, I'll show you a couple things and how that stuff comes up on Turnitin, so you can see how it works. So you can see things that look like plagiarism that may not be. But again, what I do when I write papers, not that I'm prolific on writing papers, but I just write it, you know, I study, I learn as much as I can, have all my list of references, and then I just write the paper, the whole thing in my own words, except for where I want to quote. I don't copy anything in at all and then rewrite it. I quote. So I try to limit my quote to one every two pages or something like that. It depends on what I'm writing about. And it's when you do that, it's fairly easy to get under 5% on your similarity index, so it's not hard. If you start paraphrasing where you pull stuff in and rewrite it, you'll probably easily be up to 20%, depending on how much of it you're doing. So, anyway, and then the last thing, reverse plagiarism, I wanted to talk about. Again, detection software doesn't find this. You just have to, people just run across it occasionally. The example that I think of that really is kind of interesting is there was a guy that wrote a fairly good article for a religious journal. And the editor didn't like some of his ideas. So the editor just rewrote it and published it. And it embarrassed the author. He didn't want those. He didn't mean that. He didn't say that. And so that's reverse plagiarism by editors, where they want their words to be credited to somebody else, because maybe that other person was a leader in his field, but they didn't like what he said, so he's changed it. So reverse plagiarism is a difficulty to detect. It's almost always the original author complains and does something about it. So, okay. For prevention, Benjamin Franklin. You know, being a business person, I've learned early on, you prevent yourself from getting into situations that you have to complain later. That doesn't mean like with initiative, I usually like just do it and apologize later. But when you're doing things that are unethical or that's going to create problems, you really want to avoid getting into the situation. So prevention is really worth a lot more than trying to punish students or professors or things like that for authors for plagiarism. It just, the cost is so high. I read a paper about a guy that found, he was answered the phone, and one of his associates says, "Hey, I just read an article and it's really almost exactly what you do all the time." So he read it and he said, "This guy really plagiarized me." So they started bringing charges. It was a year-long process of letters, and he suffered almost as much as the plagiarizer. It's just something you don't want to get into on either side. Now, if you think you can, you know, plagiarism itself doesn't mean you're going to win a monetary award. Now, if your book is plagiarized and somebody makes a $20 million movie out of it, you might have some financial recourse. But you have to show you actually lost, you know, so. Anyway, I like the 80-20 rule, or 80-20 rule, or 20-80 rule, or something. You know, 20% of your problem, or 80% of your problems, 20% of your people, your population does it. And, you know, from polygraphing and things like that, what I tended to find was the people that are the problem are just a small part. Everybody else does really well. And I think our students do really well. Now, it's true the undergraduates may be a little bit higher level, but I studied 360 dissertations, and the amount of plagiarism was so low. When you take away the false positives, which we'll talk about in a little bit, there really wasn't much there. You're going to get, somebody told me once, and I keep looking for stats, but it's hard to measure honesty, but his opinion was that 10% of the population are going to be dishonest no matter what. We're never going to stop it. 10% are just totally honest. They're the people that pick up your wallet and run after you. You drop this. The rest of us were somewhat in between. If we're watched, we're pretty honest. So that's the people we need to go. No, it was HRD related.
Okay.
HR, I pulled them, that was my search, HRD related, keywords that relate to that. So anyway, most of the thing that everybody says is misconceptions. Most of the students, especially students, they just don't know. They don't even know how to cite, much less tie it to a reference. And they're confused about all the different formats for references and citing. I mean, they're all confusing, and so they just have never really been taught. Some schools do, but high schools don't cover it, grade schools don't, they think it's too early. College people that are teaching college instructors, we think, well, they should know it by now, why should we bother? If they haven't got it, they're not going to get it. So I think that's really critical, that this is what we really need to tackle, the misconceptions, the things that they don't understand. So. And there's mistakes and errors. I'm sure if I go through all my papers and stuff, and I challenge you, if you think there's anything on here that isn't cited well, tell me. I'm sure you can find something there that, should you have said that or should you put that in your slides? That might be somebody else's too. I mean, it's really hard to do anything. So there are mistakes and errors, but not at 20% of a paper or 30% of a paper. Not that much. Fraud. Well, some people are just going to produce fraud. There was a medical journal that just found a fraud ring in it where one guy created several accounts, created several names, and they're all submitting, and he was actually, when you're reviewing an article to say, when you say, I don't have time, do you know anybody who will? He was then putting his other names in. He reviewed his own articles. It's amazing. There is fraud out there, but it's such a small amount. Most of it is just careless and laziness. Cultural differences. There are cultures that used to think, and probably still do, but they just kind of learned to adapt to the worldview, that knowledge is not man's to keep and be his. It's meant to be shared. So if you come from that culture, and we're teaching people like that, we have to be a little lenient with them and explain, I see your point, and I probably agree with you, but the reality of it is if you want people to be inventive and creative, we have to have some way of protecting their investment. And so you have to deal with that like that. Also, last time I did this talk, somebody said, oh wait, you left out learning styles. Wrote. He says, we sit down and memorize and memorize and memorize. So when we answer a question, we answer the memorized answer that we study. And he says, that sometimes turns up as plagiarism. So we have to be cognizant of that too. And again, we need to teach them to reword it and do it differently. But they're not doing anything wrong. They're just not fitting within our culture or our ethics. Also, too, while I'm at it, ethics are not morals. We get these really confused. Ethics and morals are two different things. Now, a lot of times, ethics are based on morals or values or personal beliefs. But the example I always look at quote is, remember when attorneys could not advertise? It was unethical. You ever watched that on TV? So the ethics changed. It's more industry-based. There's a difference. And so when we have ethics for plagiarism, it's what our industry has slowly put together to a workable situation. So we have to keep that in mind. student infractions, this is how we react. I mean, this is kind of what I do too, you know. What I have done so far is when I find plagiarism, I give, just give them a zero. I do give them a chance to rewrite it, but it's a zero. And they can resubmit either with a grade, probably reduced, but they'll get a grade. Because my goal is to get them to stop and see the difference. It's not just to throw them out of the university. Now, if they're a constant plagiarizer, the academic affairs will eventually throw them out. But they do look at the number of instances and how serious they are. But our goal is to change the way they think. Okay. And you know, some get expelled from courses, and there are some from schools. And of course, I've shown you a couple of examples where they've lost their degrees, you know, after the fact. So it is critical. Authors, even authors, when they're subjected to this, they end up, if it's just a little bit, they may ask them to rewrite and resubmit, you know, for just some self-carelessness a little bit or something like that. They sometimes articles are rejected, and maybe the journal doesn't want to get involved in the legal battle. They just don't talk about it, they just reject it. Sometimes they can be banned from publication, at least within a journal, if not word of mouth spreads, and pretty soon there's maybe a whole segment of the journal's industry that, that won't publish them. So it can destroy their career, especially in academia, because they can't publish, they're pretty much toast. You know. Sometimes the publisher will notify the institution, you know, depends how far they want to pursue it. And then, almost inevitably, if there's plagiarism involved, then it's only been published, there's an retraction, which is always very difficult to deal with. Publishers don't like to retract, because they also have to then notify all the databases, too. It's not just like they just take it off their website. They also have to make sure that it goes through the systems that it isn't referenced anymore, you know, as best it can be. So it's a very big expense for them, so they don't want to do it themselves. These people studied retractions. I think it was medical. I can't remember. There's a, you know, it's easy for them to study medical because it's much more documented, all the databases and stuff. Out of 235, they studied 235 of them. And COPE is a good website, COPE. If you want to read about different retractions, they are kind of like, they produce some adjudication processes that they suggest people go through when they have a reason to do a retraction or plagiarism or any other thing, any kind of a publishing thing. So it's good to know that. They don't really solve your problem, but they try to help you do it. They won't take sides or, you know, oh, that's plagiarism. No, they don't do that. They just how to deal with it when you suspect. Anyway, 20% were plagiarism related. So it's pretty serious. It's a pretty high amount of retractions. You know. You know, almost inevitably when you ask about your school or your journal or whatever, we have zero tolerance for plagiarism. That's the front line. But that's not really a practical line. I mean, you know, it just, it really, it's good to state that. But, and in litigation, every word does become important. So you can actually say if you have zero tolerance and these 12 words were copied, you know, then you have to, you know, if you have to go to jury, the jury's got to decide, are those 12 words important? You know, it just, it's not that you can make it go all the way through the court system. It has to be material to make it worthwhile. Anyway, let's get into Turnitin a little bit. I may have already said a couple of these acronyms, but when you use Turnitin, it produces a content originality report, COA. Okay. That means they're just looking for similarities. It's like a search. Search and, hey, I found the same thing. That's all it does. It doesn't tell you about plagiarism. It gives you the tool maybe to detect a problem, and then you have to solve it, okay? And so, three terms that are really important with Turnitin, and I assume the other ones, a later study, I'm going to compare a bunch of them and see. But Turnitin is what I use because this university has it, and it's a good tool. And most of the research shows that most of the universities and organizations and a lot of journals use that, so it's well known, okay? DSI, Document Similarity Index. That is how much of your document is similar to other documents, the DSI. that's what comes up in Turnitin right away. And believe me, it might be anywhere from 0 to 100. And it's as most likely to be 100 as it is 0. And this is what we're talking about is our documents that have been in the internet for a while. If you have a student come to you and he does a 5-page paper for you and it's like 50%, it's probably 50% plagiarized because it's new, it's unpublished. But once you publish something, I was looking at one I submitted 2 years ago and I submitted it with about 4% plagiarism. Now it's up to about 30 because it's being spread throughout the internet. And maybe even people are plagiarizing the article that the forums did. But Turnitin doesn't know that. It just says they're similar with other documents. So you have to figure out, are they plagiarizing you, or is it marketing, or is there actually a copy of your article out there someplace? Anyway, so the DSI is important, but it's only the starting point. It really doesn't mean anything. You know, if that comes up, oh, I've got a problem. Yeah, the problem you've got is you're going to have to investigate it. You know, it's not that it's plagiarized, it just is a mess, especially on pre-published stuff. The source similarity index is the SSI. That's the individual pieces of plagiarism in each of the documents that are referring to yours. And so there are tons of them. There are articles that I pulled up that have been out there 5 years that may have 400 or 500 of these things. And it becomes a real chore to decide how to deal with them. And as much logic as you can put into it, sometimes it's just subjective. I give the benefit of doubt to the author. If Turnitin says there's some similarities and I go to the source and it's not there anymore, I don't consider that plagiarism anymore. That's like, I saw that guy rob the bank. Can you describe him? No. Well, then you don't have a real witness or evidence to the crime that it happened. So this is all the work. You have to go through the SSIs and decide which are really potential plagiarism. And you can identify self or other. You can't do reverse, but you can identify at that point. If they give you enough information, and they don't always do that. They don't always do that. So hopefully, if we have time, we'll be able to demonstrate it. Anyway, after you remove the SSI, you end up with the ADSI. And that's your plagiarism factor. You're saying that you believe you have evidence of 22% of this document has been plagiarized. And that is still very subjective. If you're talking about eliminating somebody's degree, you have to be accurate. And I've seen people where they just take the two documents, especially when it's one author against another author, and they'll highlight every similarity in between the two of them. I mean, you almost have to get down to it manually. When I do my studies, when I'm doing a corpus, I mean, you know, you're just hoping that everything you're producing in the end will be pretty accurate, because there will be inaccuracies. But we're not, all we're doing is getting some stats on a corpus, so that will give us some idea of what the industry is doing, but not any legitimate accusation from some author or group of authors. So, anyway, again, published and unpublished are two different things. When we're doing student work, the plagiarism levels should be low. There should hardly be any at all. When we're doing a study with a corpus study, the longer the document's been out there, the more false positives or type 2 errors there will be. Here's some different standards, and this is where the industry really hasn't figured out anything that they want to do. Turnitin has three different colors and Turnitin is the DSI, which I just told you is meaningless for at least published articles. So they have four levels. Green, you know, when it comes up on the report, they'll be green, yellow, red, and orange. And green is 0 to 24. You can tell they're using the DSI because that would not be a document that you would allow as 24% plagiarized. That's too high, either mistakes or common things. Yellow is 48%. They don't even turn red until it's 75%. That's almost like a complete document copy when it's 75%. I mean, that's you're there's hardly anything there that isn't copied at 75%. So I think those are meaningless. I don't know, that's what they start out with. If you adjusted it down to the ADSI, there's no way I would use that. If my ADSI is 24, that's horrible.
So do these percentages exclude references and free word?
Yes, they Turnitin assumes you do that. But that's an assumption.
Well, that's an option in Turnitin.
Yeah, it's an option.
Yeah.
So.
And so if you're doing a stream of research and your references overlap, you get a high percentage.
Yes.
Even if the document itself doesn't.
Yeah. That's an anomaly that Turnitin has that you have to deal with.
Yeah.
And so all those come into, some people just delete the references and turn in the content.
But you can tell it excludes references. It's an option.
But I found several examples where it doesn't. Sometimes
okay.
It just doesn't.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, sometimes it just misses them and it starts counting them. Other times where we're going through this dissertation in the article format, sometimes the references will be with the article. So
yes.
You have reference within,
yes.
And it doesn't do that. Sometimes when you're doing an article, it has parts of other articles on the same page. And so you have some references up above it. And those will be counted as plagiarism because they're not down below where references start. So there's a lot of problems with that.
Okay.
I also found the three-word exemption. I put 10-word on my studies.
I use 5.
Yeah, I use 10. And I found many instances where I got 6 words that identified as plagiarism. Now why? I said exempt everything that's less than 10. And it found several 6-word. So I don't know how well it works. And Turnitin is a complex software, complex database. You know, we can't expect perfection. You can't even buy software like Word and get perfection out of that. I've lost several articles in years, you know, so. But anyway, that's what Turnitin suggests, so I just ignore that. That's just a tool to tell you where you think you're at the beginning. I like Thomas and De Bruin's study a lot. They have low, moderate, high, and excessive. I kind of think those are good percentages. 0 to 9. Now this is adjusted ADSI, the ADSI after you've eliminated your false positives. 9% is good. 0 to 9 that's excellent, because it's hard to even get below the 5, because you just have like National Science Foundation or something, you know, some set of words that just come up and it doesn't make sense. So that happens. 10 to 14 is still moderate. I wouldn't get upset if it's under 15. I'm sorry. Anyway, moderate is still good. High, that needs correction. That should not be allowed to be that high. That's when you have a serious problem, I think. And then, of course, when it's extremely high, at the 25 to 100%, I mean, you have major problems. This is after the adjustments. You know, that action needs to be taken. There's something there that's real bad. They have the next one, Zhang and Gia have a good one too. You know, they're pretty much the same. You know, it's a little bit different like that. And then we get into the other studies. I couldn't really tell from Mazik what he was talking about, whether it was the ADSI or the DSI. So anyway, the point of this is that there's just kind of every study has their own different versions. I took all of them together and did a little bit of interpolation between the classes and tried to figure out, and I kind of like the idea of going like 0 to 14 is low. I probably wouldn't even check it with a plagiarizing checker or notify the person if it was at that rate. If it's 15 to 24, something needs to be corrected. I wouldn't put it out or send it to a publisher that way. If it's 25 to 100, that's pretty excessive. That's after the adjustments have been taken out. And so I kind of think those work pretty good. And another study I'm going to probably do is try to add some foundation to that. My foundation is just what everybody else is doing and trying to get them to. I like 3 classes rather than 4. One guy had 8 or 10 classes, you know, like every 10% was a class. You know, that's just too much. We want it to where it's good, maybe with some work, rejected. I mean, that's kind of why I like the 3 class level. To keep it simple. Keep things simple. Things work much better, you know. So anyway. This is the one I like the best. And that's on your paper, so But we need to do research on it. We can't just arbitrarily pick something because six other people did something like that. We need to actually see how does everybody fall in after the adjustments and try to make some sense of it. Okay. Detection methods. You know, I'm just a baby in this research, so I'm sure most of you can come up with better stories on me how you found plagiarism in your class. One thing I have noticed, though, when I'm grading a paper, where I start suspecting plagiarism is when the style of writing changes. See a lot of grammar errors, and suddenly it's a paragraph of perfect grammar. Also, I've seen different fonts. I mean, literally, you know, it's one font and then something else and then another font. I mean, that's pretty odd. I wish Word would allow you to see all the control characters that are hidden. You know, they will show you the paragraph and things like that, but if they show you all the control characters, we'd probably detect a lot more plagiarism because there's a lot of control characters they may have corrected, you know, by removing or changing the font that makes have some remnants of that in there so you could still see. The cut, copy, pasting is just laughable, but, you know, we all do it, so. Anyway, text searches. Some professors will actually do text searches. They'll take, you know, a part of a sentence that seems like, wow, that's really cool. Where did this guy get this? There's nothing there other than the sentence. So they'll search for that, and they'll find another document that has it, or another website. So that works, too. Because Turnitin is a long, you know, the last one, of course, is Turnitin, which works and works well. But, you know, you submit a paper, and it might be half an hour before it's actually done. So if you're grading 70 papers, you have to submit them, and, you know, maybe by the next day they're all done. And then you still have to investigate them, so then you could end up spending another week getting rid of false positives. So, very difficult. The solution really is prevention. That's the only way we're going to tackle this. We're just going to have to live with a few that we catch and get them out of the system and take them out when they're doing bad on a continual basis. But clearly we have to take the science of plagiarizing and make people understand it. I think really most people are honest. They really are, but if they don't know anything, they get caught in doing dumb things. If you're saying to them, I want you to learn, I don't want you to copy, I can do that. I want you to learn. I want you to learn to improve your grammar. I want you to learn about something and write it in your own words. Those are skills they develop. I always justify it. If you really want a good career and you want to be a leader, how can you be a leader if you can't communicate? You know, if all you do is copy and paste, you're not going to be a good communicator. And so I try to put it to the career level. Anyway, you have to demonstrate and clarify the techniques that you want to use to the students, because several studies have shown is if you plagiarize, I'm using Turnitin, and we're going to give you a zero. It really has very little effect on the amount of plagiarizing. Very little effect. There are some, but mostly not at all, because all the good students are plagiarizing anyway. The bad ones, the 10%, they're still going to do it. But a couple studies I had where they demonstrated Turnitin and showed them how it worked, or they actually had them submit their own paper. They didn't maybe grade it, and they promised not to kick them out of the university, but they wanted them to start submitting. And what I do is give them extra credit if they submit their paper. And so, you know, the first one's high, then the next one. By the end of the semester, they're done plagiarizing. They've learned how not to. Or they've learned how to beat the system. I don't know. Maybe I'm too stupid to understand. But, you know, but the point is, I've seen some change. So it's well worth it. Also, too, you have to justify. You know, I'm an older student. I'm an adult student, to say the least. And so we need to know why. The professor will say to me, well, I want you to do this. Why? And if they don't answer that, I get hung up on it. I can't hardly move forward without knowing why. Because that's how my brain ties it together. And I can remember it. Same with plagiarism. If you say and you can justify to them why, they'll catch on. If it's because I want you to, it doesn't work. So if you can justify to them why, you will get some results. And why? It's because of their benefit. it's not my benefit, it's to their benefit. And so really critical. Students, okay. What I find that works for me, and I think I've put a little bit on the worksheet for you if you want to look at it. I keep the conversation going all semester. I don't harp on it, but here and there I inject it in and, you know, talk about it a little bit. If I get a serious paper plagiarized, I'll send out a notice to the whole class and say I don't identify anybody, of course, but I'll say I found a paper plagiarized and, you know, this is what I'm going to do, which is usually give them zero. And I said, I am so disheartened over that, you know, because I feel, not them. So, anyway. Also, the big thing is engineer assignments to discourage plagiarism. I make them put it in a format that I like, and it's not APA. It's very similar, but I'm grading this on a screen. I don't want double space. I want a single space. So I have to, and I give them the headings that I want, and they use APA for the citations and references. And by making them do that, that already discourages plagiarism. Because at worst, they're having to copy a bunch of stuff and then reformat the whole thing. And if they're lazy, they don't really like to do that. So that discourages it. I will also examine it as well as possible. I don't run it through the plagiarism tester unless I suspect it. It's just too much work. It's not, I've got 80 students in, you know, I'm talking 4 weeks to do a paper probably if I go through and take all the adjustments out of it. It's not possible. Now, maybe later we can come up with some software that just gives us a preliminary figure just when they submit it themselves. And Turnitin does that, but I'll talk about that in a minute. Anyway, feedback is a critical. When you want students to make changes, give them feedback. They do it. When I got my special format, I have a document on my website. There's a document access link for every assignment. The first time, like 50% of the papers aren't even close in the format. You know, I don't know if they're buying papers or using frat papers or their friends' papers, but they're in the format somebody else wanted, and they didn't even bother to change it. By the end of the semester, they're all doing it. You can see change if you just continually talk about it, and I take a few points off for not being in the format I want. You know, big motivation to them, just a few points. So. Also, I demonstrate Turnitin, and I have them submit their work for extra credit. The credit may not be much, but at least they get something for doing it. You know, maybe just be 1 point or 2 points or whatever. I do on the final project, they have a 5-page paper that they put together in a book. So they all produce a book about leadership, and it's based upon them watching a movie that they like. I give them a movie, but I try to pick something that they all watch. Right, we're doing Hunger Games this semester. Last semester we did Avatar. They loved it. Good projects for them. Anyway, they have to turn in their 5-page chapter that they're doing to Turnitin, and I grade it. I get 10 points on it if it's under 14%. So they see how it works. If they don't want the 10 points, they don't have to submit it. They still have their paper, and they'll get graded on that. And if I won't probably find plagiarism on it, but if I do, I'll give them zero on it. But this does teach them that, you know, how it works. And by that time, they were real familiar with it. So, authors, again, self-regulation is essential. The big thing with authors is plagiarism of self. So far, what I've found with the corpus of articles that I've done and the corpus of dissertations, the difference between the two is very minor. But the difference can totally be explained in the addition of self-plagiarism. You know, they're both, plagiarism of others is very low in both corpuses. But when you add on to the self-plagiarism, then it increases a little bit more on the articles. So it's, and again, there's some people that just totally disagree that this is just all bogus, that self-plagiarism is not an issue. We shouldn't even be talking about it.
So have the industry standards changed? Because 40 years ago, there was a national science medalist who, every single paper he did, same lab description. Now, every time he developed a test, it was a different chemical in the test.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see why he would have to rewrite his lab setup every time.
Well, I think there's an exemption in the APA that says methodology can be
Well, that's what I thought, but that's the point. You need to run it in through...
Well, see, but that has to be an adjusted ABSI.
So I mean, I tend to work in a certain area. I've had an editor say, he knows me, said, would you rewrite this? It's, you know, overlapping the proceedings, but the reality is it's very clear in the proceedings that it says the author retains total ownership.
Well, that's true.
So it's like, okay, fine, I'll rewrite it to make you happy.
Well, but that's an exemption that if you own your article, you can repeat it over and over again, I think, as long as you own the copyright of it.
Correct.
But there's very few publishers that don't take the copyright. And
even then, they sometimes grant it to students for purposes of dissertation.
Well, yes, a person that has a dissertation can produce an article from it almost word for word.
And vice versa, if they publish first. It depends on the publisher.
Yeah, that could be. Yeah, I don't know.
I've checked it.
Yeah. But those things, again, are what complicate the whole issue.
Exactly.
You know, because there are so many exceptions. And again, I've got a slide on it later, but I'd rather just talk about it right now. There was a guy by the name of Shinky. He was very high up in the ethics profession, you know, writing about articles. And he was, if I remember right, I don't remember all the exact details. He wrote books and everything about ethics, about publishing and research, and he was appointed like the ethics director of some big association. I've got a reference, we'll pull that up so you can check it out if you want. There was a professor teaching a class about ethics in some university, and they talk about that too. I don't remember. But, he produced Shinky's papers, handed them out to his students, and he said, now I want you to read this and really understand the ethics of it. This guy really knows what he's doing. Well, it was a PhD class, so they're all questioning everything anyway. And one of the students goes, these four articles are basically the same. They're with different publishers. And so the professor looked at him and goes, yeah. Well, you just got done talking about plagiarism of self. What is this? They notified the publishers. They had to retract one of the articles. They had to decide what to do with his professor. He could have lost his job. And anyway, politics being politics, he ended up writing a paper. I don't know if it was an apologetic paper, but it was definitely explained how it happened. And I did, and that paper is what I studied, got a lot of information from. Anyway, the committee that was handling all this, I guess that association that he worked for, came to those students and said, would an apologetic type paper be enough? They could have said, no, we want him out. They didn't. They said, oh, okay. So he lucked out. But, I would not be subject to the chance, no matter what, given that. These students took that guy to task. Now, again, prevention is the key. It's not after the fact trying to wiggle out of it. So anyway, okay. I would say all authors, when they submit an original document, that you can beat the 5% pretty easy. It depends. Highly technical things. And also, too, if your methodology is a repeat, the APA says that's okay. If the methodology is your only problem and it's a repeat of your own stuff, then that's okay. But then you should put a note maybe in your dissertation or your article that is a repeat, so you warn the reader that it's not.
Situation in class, when I asked students to submit their papers in Turnitin, and they said actually what happened to them is they submitted the papers in class to Turnitin. Later, when they try to publish the paper, somehow the paper is shown as having plagiarized.
You have to exclude it from the database.
Yeah,
but
there's I'll show you that. There's an option where when you set up the assignment for them to submit, it will exempt them from the database, so it won't go into the database.
So the other thing about that is, and this happened to me this is how I learned it the hard way, because I was testing something I was going to submit, and then it shows up as plagiarizing. You can exclude that document, if you know it's yours.
Yeah.
Even afterwards, you can still do that.
You can, yeah.
Redo the analysis without
that one. Right, we exclude that document.
cheaters. They have one student take all the professor's notes and the test questions, everything, and pass to future students. What do we do with this kind of situation?
Well, I think the technology will catch up to where it will be faster and can actually run, you know. One of the things, I try to automate a lot of my grading. It'll be a time when you want to see it. I can run an article through it, and it'll use the grammar checker in the Word, highlight all the sentences, and give it back to them, and shows everything that's wrong with the document. I'm thinking about if I can figure out how to tie into Turnitin, or tie into even just Google search engines, maybe take that document a sentence at a time, and, you know, go in two words on each end, and take the middle and run it through and see if I can detect any kind of significant similarities. So, yeah, as far as you're talking about big cheating organized rings like frats, have been known to do that. I mean, you just have to be watching for it. Usually, though, what I find is, I just got a paper from a person the other day, and I gave him an F on it. I didn't give him a zero, because if I choose something, then I'll give him something. But it was just a perfect template. Oh, it was pretty. Real pretty. It's supposed to be three pages, and each page is supposed to be about 500 words. It's 300 words. Double spaced, you know, title page, and, you know, it went on and on, but there was nothing there. I mean, and I don't even think he wrote the thing. They probably just have a bank they just pull out of it. Oh, that kind of fits. They maybe search leadership, and 40 documents come up, and they go, I'll take that one and turn it in. And that's, so usually, you know, if you specify three pages plus references, no title page, capital, you know, your title and capitals, and they don't do that, that's enough for you to be suspicious right now. And then, if it's just totally a different format, chances are it's just something they had or they got from somebody. So
the more you recycle old exams, the more likely that is to happen. I personally post all my old exams in Blackboard for them.
Yeah, that's true. My course now is all writing, but I used to do, when I was teaching programming, I had, you know, 1 through 100 point exams of questions. I had like 500 questions, and I'd randomly pick them out.
Right.
And there are negatives and positives. One semester, it would be true. The next semester, the same question, just a few words would be false. And you'd catch them on that. So, again, engineer your class to try to beat them at these games. And if you're, and rather the, you know, make them so that it becomes very difficult for them to do that. For instance, one of the things I do is kind of change assignments as I'm going through the semester. I've got the assignment given, and if they do that, that's fine. But then I'll say, oh, why don't you add this to it? You'll do really better if you do that. Well, then you can see like 20% of your students did that. They're the people that are conscientious and paying attention. The other people might be just dragging stuff out from 5 semesters before. One of the things I do want to do is build up a database of the stuff that's been turned into me, and then be able to check that for similarities. I'll write some software to do that, and that way I have my own little database. At least I know they're not pulling out pieces of the conversation and the discussion, putting it in the paper or somebody else's paper from, you know, their buddy's paper from 2 years ago. So it's tough. I can appreciate what you're talking about. Just try to open that door. For editors and reviewers, you know, we always have a couple editors in our departments that, you know, they deal with it. And also we have almost everybody's a reviewer at the faculty level, and most of your doc students are there too. You know, it's good to have a practical policy that works. And usually that just comes from years of experience. You can't just lay down the law and say this is what we're going to do. You have to find out what works. So sometimes it means backing off. Sometimes it may mean going in a different direction. And you have to train reviewers. I was talking to a professor the other day. He said a reviewer reviewed a paper, and there was a little red insignia or something on it. And she didn't really understand what the insignia was. It meant that it was plagiarized. Well, how would she know that? And then how would she know she hadn't do anything about it? Was she supposed to reject the paper because it's plagiarized? You know, no, I thought that was the editor's job. The reviewer just might, you know. So, and if you want the reviewer to check for plagiarism, are they going to be skilled enough to do false positives? You know, what the paper, you know, it's just very difficult. you know, it should be a new article, so it should be relatively low, period. You know, even without adjustments, but you still need to do adjustments even on an article that has already been done, or is brand new, a new article. Also, too, editors have to support the adjudication process. Are they going to want to get into an adjudication on plagiarism? You know, it becomes time-consuming and expensive. But they have a reputation, so that's their job. So they should do it. So, anyway, stumbling blocks. Also, make sure you don't discriminate. I was just reading about some lawsuit about somebody that was suing the university for being accused of plagiarism several times. It wasn't just one time. And they were expelling him, and he was then suing the university based on race. He said, well, they just check people of color. That's really, you know, that's what they look, which is really unfair. But that's, I mean, if that's what they do, then that is indefensible. Also, a thorough investigation is demanding of the process. The deeper you get into it, you can't just, well, Turnitin says. Turnitin, first page on the page, and it says, do not take that. This similarity does not mean plagiarism. That's your decision. You know, it's just potential evidence. Okay. Okay, also, too, there was another lawsuit I saw where they didn't really get a response from the author or the student. I can't remember. It can be, it doesn't matter. But you have to allow the author to justify what they did or explain it. It's kind of like the police interviewing the suspect. You've got to have their input. And you have to demand it. If they're kind of shy, you demand it. They don't have to do it, but they need that chance to explain, because it might be a misunderstanding. Very possible. I ran into one paper that was really high plagiarism, and really he posted it to Eric, his paper, and Eric is like a dissertation. It's research the government takes. You can turn that into an article, so that's acceptable. It looks to turn it to like plagiarism, but it's not, because you have the authority. A lot of government projects you work on, you can take whatever your research shows, unless it's restricted or something, and then you can turn it into an article. So, you know, there's all these exceptions, so how can anybody know?
I would put a caveat on that. Maybe that's legal to do that, but you should still cite that source.
Oh, no, yeah, yeah, you should still cite
but
it.
But even if you cited, editors these days don't like the overlap.
Well, that's
so
a separate issue.
But
why not get a
rewriting?
But I think it's wrong to just take it. I mean, like, there's a book on Kanye with Eric. It's in the public domain. But if somebody cited something of that, I use something of that without citing the source, you're right, I would reject it.
Yeah.
Because
so
I think it's wrong.
So it's just better that even if you cite the source, you're better off rewriting these days.
Yeah. That's the easy thing, is just rewrite it in your own words, period. Unless you're willing to use quotes.
Yeah. But even if it's your own document, I suggest you rewrite it.
Yeah.
Because the current software will detect it, the editor will be suspicious, you don't need to go through the hassle.
Yeah, that's true. Anyway, let me show you a little bit. I know some of you use this extensively, so you really understand it, but I'll show you a little bit what I've done with it here. See this okay? One of the things that I suggest is, like, I have a start here page, and you know, my schedule and what the course is about, you know, and then where they introduce themselves and stuff. One of the things I do is I put this right here: testing your rough drafts using Turnitin, not graded. So they can submit anything, and sometimes I find them submitting papers from other classes. I mean, if they take this class, They have an account now, they can submit, they can look at it. I see what they do, but I don't really use it for anything. You know, sometimes it'll just be a set of slides or something.
and they'll submit it, and then I assume they're turning it in or getting it ready to turn it into my class or another class, or you know, who knows what they're doing. I don't really follow that. But I do, when I get into my learning module, final project, I do ask them, see, I have where they submit it first to Turnitin, and I give them 10 points if it's in good shape. So they actually get some points from it that they have to do, and they'll see how, and they should have already had some practice with the other one. So, in fact, they can take and run it in the other end and see if it's okay, and then submit it here. I don't really care, but this is what I'm going to grade. If they don't have it, they lose 10 points, which is basically, you know, a letter grade off of the assignment. And then they actually can turn the assignment in. Now, you can do the Turnitin and assignment together, but you lose a lot of capability. The Turnitin does it, so I like to just keep them separate. It would be nice if you could just put on your assignment when you're formulating that you just have a checkbox, run through Turnitin, and it would do that and report to you right when you're grading the thing. That would be nice, but right now it's a dual system and you have to kind of mess with both of them.
So when you're having them do this, you're having them excluded from the database at that point?
I've already set that.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
I've already set that. Yeah, I don't want it in our database. So.
Yeah, I agree, because then they can't use it later if they need something
yeah.
substitute.
Yeah, so I exclude that, so but it gives them a good idea what's going on. So. So anyway, that's what I do there. Let me show you. I'm not going to show you any students' work because it's not really ethical. But let me know. I do want to show you what for you that have never actually seen Turnitin, the interface. I have a little organization I started. I mean, it's just me. But I got Blackboard to do that. And so I can go in and, you know, I can use this to teach academics. Understanding plagiarizing and copyright issues. I don't know why it's not going to it real easy. There we go. Okay. Assessment. Oh, I see. It's because my screen isn't as big. Ah, there we go. Okay. This is where they can submit a doc. This is what the student sees right here. They can submit, you know, their name, and you know, they can put whatever name in it they want. They don't have to sign in. And so then when they submit it, then it will run the report. And I have it set so they can look at their reports, because you don't have to do that. Okay, then let's see if I can get this to messages. Okay, to actually see the documents, you have to go to the messages, then you go back to the assignment box. Okay, then here's all the different papers I've submitted through the years. Here is sorted by titles. Okay, here's an assignment one of my students sent me, and I took their names off of it. They're at 2%. They're just 3-page documents, but both of them are at 2% now. So there's no similarity really to speak of at all. That's probably just like the name of the university or something. 1 or 2% is usually just like simple stuff that you wouldn't even think of catch. Okay, here's my dissertation, if it will come up. Oh, there it goes. Okay, 3%. It comes up, and then you hit the originality report. And this is what it shows you. The DSI is 3%. Right there. That's the DSI. That's where it starts at when you first initially load it in. And these are the SSIs. These are the similarities it finds. And there may be a couple hundred of them, even on a paper with 3%. And the really thing that drives you crazy is maybe you have one sentence in there in 200 documents. And you have to delete all the 200 documents if you want your DSI to go down. And it's not easy. You know, sometimes if they're underneath each other, you just delete the tree. But it isn't easy. But anyway, those are the things you need to check out. See how it highlights the colors right there? This is real common. See, probably 3% of my dissertation is present day or dissertation prepared for the degree of doctor of. I mean, it's a million. I mean, it's just all over the internet. So that's where a lot of your under 5% comes from. It's not really plagiarism. It's just template similarities. It's even worse with articles, when you're doing old articles that have been done, because they'll have all their copyright on the bottom, their names on the top, all their information that they have on thousands of articles. And so you're almost starting out at 10% right away on an article with no plagiarism. So that's why it works best when it's a new document that's never been published. But when it's a document that has, you have a lot of work cut out for you. So anyway, I want to scroll up and down and see what else we can find. Oh, you can actually pick somebody, like if I want to find out what this is about, you can click on this and see it shows. Look at all the words that I have. It's identifying all these words. And they're like common words. I mean, they're just charts and tables really get picked up because you're using the same kind of things over and over again. So it's very difficult to figure all that out. I want to close this one up. I mean, you can just go through this document. You know, sometimes this touch screen works and sometimes it doesn't. Okay, here's that article I wrote. I'm up to 23% now, which is bad. That's bad. It started out at about 5% or less, if I remember right. That was 2-3 years ago, but now it's at 23, which tells me that there's a lot of activity with this thing, and you'll see what it is immediately. If I can get it up. Let's see. Oh yeah, there it goes. I have these short, stubby fingers, and they're just too big to touch the spots I want. Okay, see, it's warning me that it's excluded the bibliography. Okay, which I told it to. Okay, so anyway, 12% IGI Global, that's who published it. So that's why it's seeing itself in a way, or it's seeing marketing efforts by IGI. And I think, so the title, obviously.
Or IGI published it in a book if you agreed to it as a chapter, and then you know about the significance of the article.
Right.
Yeah.
But those references are after the original publication? It finds all of them? You can't just have it look for prior publications?
No, that's a big improvement if it would. If
I
you
think
could say.
Does that.
That might be, but.
Yeah.
I don't see. I haven't been able to figure that out.
We just had a recent one with Springer which uses
yeah.
Authenticate. And
okay.
Only previous publications showed up.
Okay, I wanted to get down to the abstract, and apparently I don't know what I'm doing with my paper here.
You can change the page number there.
Where?
On the bottom right.
By?
It says page 1 of 19.
Yeah, I see. Is there a space for it?
No, maybe. Sorry.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not sure why. It's a touch screen, and you know, I probably need a mouse and I could do it easily. But I was going to go down to the abstract. It was totally red. And then when you start going through the document, there's hardly anything there. The abstract added about 10% to it, you know, the chapter, the name, stuff like that. And there's really not much more out there in there. Oh, there's some titles that I used, and those titles are there. In a dissertation, almost all of your table of content is plagiarized. because we use the same one in almost every document. So that comes up, you have to eliminate that. So it's, you know, it's one of those things. Anyway, I wanted to finish show you. But I didn't show you the method of the settings, but there's settings. You mentioned about the number of words. You can tell it to exclude either percent or words. I haven't figured it. I tried the percent a couple times, and it didn't seem to really work right. Percent's not good. Words works, but even it doesn't work all the time. And you say exclude references, it doesn't always exclude references. There are some documents I found where I didn't see anything incorrect at all, and some of the references were highlighted as plagiarized. You know, so, in fact, I found one where all the references were plagiarized almost. So in that case, when I evaluated the document, there's no way to get rid of that because they're referenced in 20,000 documents. So it's just impractical. So I just figured out the percentage and took that off when I adjusted it, you know, and just manually made an adjustment to the ADSI. So that worked. Okay, let me see if I can bring my thing back up here. We're almost done here, so I did want to show this. Okay. It's still a problem even at schools. This school here, a whole group of students were plagiarizing. That was kind of like your question back there, what do you do when you have a group? You know, that does happen. They all received, you know, it ended up being they discovered it all and they took action. They got zero for grades. That's probably more often, a lot more common than you think. So, but this one was interesting. These people paid for a cruise to go out and, you know, get a credit, 3-hour credit to go on a cruise and travel all over, and they had to write a research paper probably about where they were going. And one of the students plagiarized tremendously, I guess. They pulled her off the boat. I think that's what it said. And she got a 0 for the grade, and she did not get her money back on that. Because in the document, that was all spelled out. And in cheating or plagiarizing, you were out.
But if you actually read this, or it's her extent, I mean, because it's unique, you're on a cruise, you can't plagiarize the event. So it says she was expelled for taking pre-sentence fragments.
Yeah.
So now it comes down to what's a fragment.
It's
common terminology to the context that she's using, then somebody could be overly zealous, which is possibly why it's in court. Well, the term of the issue might have simply paraphrased.
Yeah, but that was her self-report. Maybe that's
exactly.
Yeah,
of course.
Actually,
I know.
Yeah, because see, they're probably not saying anything. They're not saying anything.
Right. You can see it go both ways.
Oh no, and I think that's where we have to be patient because our job is to teach and not. I think that's a little extreme.
I think that's right.
But with this example here, I'm not saying that's how we need to treat our students, not at all.
No,
but I'm just saying how we can get tangled in this web of plagiarism really easy, and when we didn't even expect it or understand it, you know. So anyway, this was just a whole bunch of stuff. They plagiarizing, collusion, recycling goes. That really refers to what the gentleman's question back there was. That, you know. Hopefully somebody, the only way you can probably figure this stuff out is when they really develop a system that's been on for years, is that somebody tattles on, somebody breaks the bond for some reason, you know, maybe it's somebody that's being thrown out for some other reason, you know, and then he decides, well, if I tell you about this, so, I mean, schools have to be investigators. They can't just, I don't want to get into that, that's not my job. You know, they need to always be looking for these kind of things. They're rare, but they do occur. So we shouldn't be looking for them. And here's Dr. Schimke, who's the guy that was accused of self-plagiarism and had to retract one of his articles. And as he paid the price. And it was students that pursued it. Or at least they found it, and then the professor pursued it. Because what else could he do? Oh, that's okay. He's kind of famous. We don't have to pursue it. So things can happen that you don't expect. You know. Anyway, I love this sentence. I say this for all my plagiarism. You know, perish those who set our good things before we did. That's our attitude. You know,
We would have thought of that. We would have said that. I've thought that many times. You know, it's not plagiarism until it's put in some kind of a material thing like a paper or a video or anything like that. Once it becomes a physical thing, it's, you know, you can say it's yours if you're the first one to do it. And if it's a common sense statement, people will say, well, I could have thought of that too. And most people do. So anyway, thank you very much. And if there's any other questions you have or anything you can teach me, I'd appreciate it. This is going to be a lifelong learning thing for me, you know, ethics and legal and stuff like that. So, you know, I know many of you have had stories that probably make my stories very small. So anyway, we still have plenty of desserts. So enjoy yourself. I hope I didn't take too much of your afternoon away from you.
Thank you very much. So
thank
any
you.
Other questions? Thanks everybody for coming and
Thank you.
My pleasure.
Thanks for having me.